When he got back, he did a circuit of teaching in synagogues, and then went to his home synagogue. He was doing a circuit of teaching in synagogues in Galilee. When he got to his church, where we are in our passage, which would be his synagogue, when he got to his synagogue, which was the synagogue in which he was raised as a child of Nazareth, our story picks up as he comes back. Let's just start with verse 14 and get a picture of this. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. See, in verse 13, the devil had finished every temptation and left him. Now watch this in verse 13. See, that's the temptation story when Jesus was led in the wilderness, yada, yada. And it closes, Luke closes it, when the devil had finished every temptation, remember we went through three, he left him until an opportune time. The devil is always looking for an opportune time for the angelic to wage war against you as a believer. All right? Opportune time. Now, in verse 14 and 15, Jesus has began his circuit teaching. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through all the surrounding districts, and he began teaching in their synagogues and was being praised by all. Now he has come to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as was his weekly custom, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. That's by invitation. He read from the prophet's book, Isaiah, and he opened the book to Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And he read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recover of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord." In verse 20, then he closed the book and he gave it back to the attendant of the synagogue, and he sat down. Eyes of all the congregation of the synagogue were fixed on him, and he began to say to them, watch this now, today. Now, he just read from a scripture that had been written by Isaiah. This is 500-600 years later. He began to say them today. This scripture that has laid waiting for prophecy fulfillment for over 500 years, today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Right? What scripture is he talking about? He's talking about Isaiah 61. If you have a study Bible, you know that. Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And all were speaking well of him and wondering at the gracious words which were falling from his lips. And they were saying, "Is this not Joseph's son?" Then he gets in another conversation with him. I just want to focus on his message, right? I just want to focus on his message, what he gave to them. He pulled out a messianic prophecy. Isaiah 61 was a landmark prophecy of his coming, of the Messiah's coming. It was a landmark. It is like a John 3:16 to us. Everybody really had an understanding about Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. Now, he's been teaching this as he's been going around. Now he comes to his home church and he's teaching the same thing. And what he has told them is this scripture, this messianic scripture, this that has been laying ready to be fulfilled, today has been fulfilled. Did he use the word fulfilled? Did he use the word fulfilled? Yeah, he did. What was being fulfilled? What the scriptures were saying. He took something that was old and ancient as far as messianic history and brought it into current events and news. And the news of this message was going wildfire, right? It was spreading across wherever he had been and brought this message. The news was spreading like wildfire that this Jesus of Nazareth of Galilee, this guy is declaring the fulfillment of Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And there was a buzz going on. A buzz, a news buzz. Let me, because you might have had a New Year's Eve. The buzz I'm talking about is another, it's news, a news buzz. All right? So what I want you to do now, watch. How did verse 13 stop the great temptation of the devil against Jesus? You can read about it in Luke 4. What were the last words? The devil left him to wait for another opportune time. Just because you beat him in one warfare don't mean you've got him whipped. He's not going to be whipped till Jesus comes back a second time. So, the devil is always looking for an opportune time. Opportune time. Right? Let me show it to you. Let me show you his opportune time. Because he's going to jump in the middle of this mess. He's going to jump right in the middle of Jesus' messianic ministry and try to blow it apart. Watch this now. Let me show you how the devil gets an opportunity, a foothold in your life. You ready? Watch this. It's in our passage, but you missed it. It's in verse 22. The opportune time that the devil was looking for, he got. Jesus came out, read this great messianic passage. This is Luke 4:22. Read this great messianic passage in detail, laid it out in detail, and then said, today this scripture is fulfilled. All right? Now watch this. What did the people say? What did his home synagogue? This is the synagogue he grew up in. He went to this synagogue every Saturday that he was home. How do I know that? Because the words, as was his custom. Do you remember that? It's what he said. I make this up. As was his custom. The devil is looking for opportunity. Listen, he looks for opportunities to get to you at Bible study. Because you're not listening to what you're hearing. You know why you fail a test when you go to school? While you sat in class every day and then flunked the final? You know why? Because you didn't listen to what you were hearing. So here it is, verse 22. Here was their response. Here is how the people responded in verse 22. Is this not Joseph's son? You know what Isaiah 61, 1 and 2 says? Isaiah 7:14 says that the Son is the Son of God. His name is Emmanuel. That's Isaiah 7:14. Now we're in Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And Jesus said, I'm that guy. And they said, we got doubts about that. I think he's Joseph. But listen, we already know from Isaiah 7:14, which is quoted in Matthew 1 to Joseph when Mary came back pregnant after 3 months' trip. You have read, come on, that's Christmas stuff. We're in a new year now. We're in the favorable year, right? Nah, you missed that one too. Listen, you got to listen to what you hear. or you're not going to get it between your ears. Now watch this. Now watch this. They said, is not this Joseph's son? He's the son of God. Isaiah 7:14 said, already declared him to be the son of God. We're in 61, says that his ministry is going to be the Messiah that goes to the cross and dies for the sin of humanity, is buried and raised from the dead to give humanity life everlasting. That's called the gospel. When they said, is not this Joseph's son? They opened the door for Satan, because that's not the truth. They were questioning Isaiah 61. They were questioning that today. Now, here's another thing they're going to miss. Listen, and the devil's going to jump inside of this group of people. He's going to jump inside this group. Look at the same congregation. The same congregation, drop down to verse 28. I haven't had prayer yet, have I? I can start to feel my engine. Watch this. The same congregation now who wondered at the great, verse 22, who wondered at the gracious words which were falling from the lips of Jesus, are now filled with such rage as you read 28 and 29, they want to kill him. They are going to kill him. They were filled with rage as they heard these things, and they got up and drove him out of the city, led him to the brow of a hill on which the city had been built, in order to throw him off the cliff. So much for church. This is a congregation of people looking for the Messiah. When he comes, they want to throw him off a cliff. I don't know what you want to do with him, but I tell you what you ought to do with this new year with him. You ought to believe him when he said, I came to die for your sins, to be buried and raised from the third day to give you life everlasting. I'm going to take your spiritual death and I'm going to give you eternal life. Because if you die in your Adamic sin, wherefore is by one man, Adam, sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so the death, sin death, spread to all mankind. Only way out from that, my dear heart, is faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't be as stupid as these people were. They heard, but they didn't listen. One more idea, and then I'm going to have a word of prayer with you. The favorable year of the Lord. Watch this. When Jesus read this, he laid out and he closed with this line, verse 19, that he had come to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. Is that... That's Isaiah 61, 1 and 2, agreed? Is that scripture being fulfilled in the day of... Was that scripture coming to be fulfilled in the day of the Messiah? So guess what year you live in? Guess what year you live in? Could be a gate question. You know, when you get to Pearly Gate, he might say... And you give him... Well, the favorable year of the Lord. Do you know that America, the land of the home, free and all that, used to believe this? Do you know the America that I was born into and lived in believed that the favorable year is whatever year was on your calendar? Did you know that? Do you know that the old church that preached the word of God would have told their people, as I am telling you, that you live in the favorable year of the Lord, 2023? Did you know that? That's no longer part of our national stance. As a nation, we don't believe that, nor do we teach that. And I'm afraid the church has walked lockstep with a nation in decline. Let's have prayer, and I'll get to a few points, and then we're going to do the Eucharist. If you're here with us today and you believe the gospel of Christ, that he died for your sins personally, was buried and raised from the dead, and you personally accept that, then your name has been written in the book of life, your personal name. It's a personal thing. If that's true, then the Eucharist is for you. You live in the favorable year of the Lord. I mean, every year that you live is a favorable year. Isn't that wonderful? You know, people go, well, what kind of a year had? Well, I had a terrible year. What kind of a year did you have, Ron? You know what my answer is? A favorable year. That's the only kind I have. It's for me to understand that and live that. And so, our Father, we understand that we're saved, but are we filled with the Spirit? Do we understand that the moment we believed, we received the indwelling of the Holy Spirit that turned our body in the temple of God? And the Holy Spirit lives with us in John 14, 16 to the end of time. Our time. Never leave us nor forsake us. And that is the power to live the Christian life as indwelling Holy Spirit. When we come to Bible class, if we're going to listen to learn in order to live, learn, listen, listen, learn, and live. I pray, Father, that we would understand that when there's sin in our life, we confess it as a believer. We name it. In 1 John 1:9, we confess our sin, and he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us, which restores us to spirituality, to the ministry of the indwelling Holy Spirit, who in John 14, 26, Father, reminds us that he is the great teacher of the Word of God in our souls. He can bring the Word of God into a personal place in our life. I pray for that today as we finish this study, and then the Eucharist in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let me take you to our paper for just a moment, if you don't mind. We've covered this passage in general terms. When he opened the scriptures, he did what I just asked you to do. What did I just ask you to do before we really get into the study? What did I ask you to do? I said, I want you to be sure that you confess sin in order for the indwelling ministry to have a ministry with the Word of God with you. He is the real teacher of the Word of God. He's the real teacher. Even Jesus had to do that. He had to be aware of the ministry of the Holy Spirit to the congregation or to the people he was addressing. Listen to what he said now. You didn't get that. The Holy Spirit is upon me. That was Jewish age. In the church age, he's inside you. In the Jewish age, he was next to you. He was upon you, not in you. But you and I have the Holy Spirit. When you believe the gospel, then he takes up residence inside your body, and your body becomes the temple of God, 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. We don't pray the Holy Spirit be upon us. We pray the Holy Spirit go out of us and minister. Minister into me and minister out of me. That's the way the Holy Spirit operates in this dispensation. We live in the favorable year of the Lord. Every year is the favorable year of the Lord. Now the Jews are looking for something like a jubilee. It ain't going to happen in this dispensation. The favorable year of the Lord, Jesus said, is now active. It's not inactive, it's active. Every year, it is a favorable year of the Lord. So, listen, Jesus fulfilled the Sabbath system. Come on now. Well, you'll learn all that if you come and stay with me a year. Got to stay with me a year, though. You can't be a casual student of the Word. Come stay with me a year. You'll see the whole idea of transformation by the Spirit and the Word of God in your life. Come stay a year. Come stay a year. Watch this. Listen what Jesus said. That the Spirit of God is upon me, and God appointed me. God the Father appointed God the Son. Watch this now. Watch this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Watch this. He anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Write this on your paper now. Matthew 5:3. What's he talking about? Poor people in their pocket? No, poor people in their spirit. He's talking about Matthew 5:3. Poor in their spirit. They don't have a relationship with God as their Father. That can only come through Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and life. And no man can come to the Father except through me. So he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, those who are hungry, those who are thirsty, those are words of speaking about the way you feel in your spirit towards God. A hunger for God, a thirst for God, for the Holy Spirit, for the Word of God. Secondly, watch what he said. He said, God the Father has sent God the Son, he, me, to proclaim, watch this now, to proclaim release to the captives. Who are they? Watch this now. Colossians, write this down. On that point, write Colossians 1:13. Because when Jesus Christ goes to the cross, is buried and raised from the dead, he is now able to rescue those who are perishing, rescue them from the domain of darkness, and transfer them into the kingdom of the beloved Son. Those in the domain of darkness are captive. They're under Adam's sin. Did you write that down? Recovery of sight to the blind. Are we talking physical? Well, he did do that physically to show that he could do it spiritually. He healed a blind man to show that he was Messiah and could do that to their entire life. He wasn't just after eyes. Jesus didn't come for eyes. He came for souls, right? He used the eye as a way to get to the soul. He healed a guy and said, look, what does that prove to you? Well, it proved, now, what did that what prove to him? What did it prove to you? It proved that you're the Messiah. Then the Messiah comes for the soul. He is the great shepherd of the sheep. Well, write this down about the blind. Let me tell you the blind he is really looking for, 2 Corinthians 4:4. The blind he's really looking for could well be you sitting here today. No spiritual insight to God and into a personal relationship. Ron, I pray and I can never get answers. You know why? You got to be born again. You got to be born again. Your natural birth can't get you into prayer and into the presence of God. You got to be born again. John, the 3rd chapter, not just verse 16, 1 through 16. Yeah, John 1 through 6, 6 3, 1 through. Then he said, he has sent me to free those who are oppressed. You know what's wonderful about this idea? Isaiah, write this down. Isaiah 58:6 is another messianic prophecy that said that's what he would do. The worst oppressed that you can have is demonic. Now, only unbelievers can have that. Isaiah 58:6. Okay, to the oppressed. Now, listen, you know who these people are? Look, before I go any further, the poor, the captive, the blind, the oppressed, you know who all these people are? They're your neighbors. They're the young people you go to school with in high school and college. They are your neighbors in your neighborhood. They're the people that work where you get gas and where you go have lunch. These are the people you live among. Can you see them that way? See, Jesus looked at people with spiritual eyes, not physical eyes. Do you see these people in your neighborhood? They're there. They were in his neighborhood. Why aren't they in yours? They're in mine. You know where my neighborhood is? Wherever my body is. If it goes to the grocery store, that's my community. If I don't care. Wherever I am, that's where our ministry is. Those young guys, you should be able to see this in Willie. You should be able to see it. You probably can't see it in my life because you don't run in my circles. I take you. You could run with me in my circles if you wanted to. I couldn't keep up with you, probably. And you want to see this? You hang out with Willie. You young people, hang out with Willie. He sees the oppressed. He sees the poor, the naked, the hungry. But he sees them spiritually. And he wants desperately to have them have a relationship with God that he has found. It's true with all of us. That's why this couple over here, they travel all over the world. There are international missionaries, and they travel all over the world where God sends them to tell people the story that we're not interested in hearing in America anymore. They go all over the world to tell the story that we're not interested in America anymore because the church isn't. The reason the story's not being told, nobody goes out and tells it. You know how this story got told? Jesus went out and told it. He said, I've been anointed. Can you imagine Jesus saying he'd been anointed? Well, listen to what he was saying. He was fulfilling prophecy. God, it's Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And he has sent me. Notice the word sent. I put it three times on your paper because that's the word. Did you notice that? Now, can you do this? At some point, reach deep into your heart. Can you change the word me to your name? Because listen, in Christ, this is fulfilled in your life. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. If you're in Christ, this is in you. Do you understand that? This favorable, everything that he said he was going to do is in fulfillment of the favorable year of the Lord. And that's every year until he returns. You know, when we started counting this, do you suppose 2023 is all the years we have in human history? That's all we got? Come on now. Even when they go to outer space, they talk about billions of years, right? Where did this idea, the favorable year of 2023, come from? It came from the historical identity of the incarnation of Jesus Christ. That's why it's the favorable year of the Lord is 2023. Next year it'll be 24, and it'll be 25, and it'll be 26. You know what's wonderful? I jumped into that. This is live stream. This countdown of 2000 to 23, all of a sudden, God in his favor dropped me into this age bracket. And I've been swimming upstream ever since. You got a birthday? You got a birthday? That's when you got dropped in that stream. You got a new birthday? You got a born-again birthday? Well, hold that close, because that's when you got an anointing to do the things of God. There's not a person in this building that has believed the gospel of Jesus Christ that doesn't have an anointing, and God's heart is to send you to the poor, the hungry, the needy, who have spiritual needs in their life. I have never in my life seen a generation of young people so filled with anxiety as I have today. I meet with young people who are filled with anxiety and don't know why. They just don't know. I feel bad all the time, Ron. I'm nervous about everything. I just can't seem to get my legs under me. What is wrong with me? Listen to me. There's nothing wrong with you. You live in that kind of a culture today, and the only way you'll ever get legs under you is through Jesus Christ. You've got to believe that He came into this world for you, and the world has stomped your heart out of you. You go to the devil's side of the world, and he'll beat you up and make you feel worthless than anything you can imagine. And all God wants to do is heal you. You need to be open to that. We live in the favorable year of the Lord, which means you have an anointing on you, and God wants to send you to the people that you influence in your life. You got people in your family. You got guys you play ball with that need Christ. They come to you and they don't know what they're going to do. And they go to drugs, they go to alcohol, they go to sex, they go to all the wrong places to think they can climb some way out and find their own identity, and it's never there. That's the devil's opportune time to drag you down and make you feel worthless. Even so worthless that you don't think you could be saved. He's a liar. His nature is to lie and deceive and destroy. Don't let him have you. You're the only one that can give yourself to him. Don't give it. Every church age believer lives in the favorable year. In the Greek language, it's dektos. I put it on your paper, just in case you didn't know what it meant. It means acceptable and welcomed. So, I am through with that. I want to do the Eucharist with you. We'll see where we go. So open your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, if you have a Bible on your phone, I would recommend that. To do it, or there's a Bible in your pew. You can look at 1 Corinthians, that's New Testament, and the 11th chapter. And we're going to start in verse 23. Does everybody have this kind of thing with them? If you don't, well, an usher will bring it to you. Okay. All right. Before I read, let me tell you who qualifies. There's two ordinances in the church. One is baptism and one is the Eucharist. You should only have one water baptism. When Willie gets you, when he puts you in a the tub, when it's 23 out, you never forget that baptism. You never forget it. And Willie doesn't blink an eye because he said, I got baptized in that kind of weather. So don't whine to me because I'm the wrong guy. So the Eucharist is for believers, those who believe that Jesus died for their sins, was buried and raised from the dead third day. That's the qualifications to take part in the Eucharist. And if you have that, then you're commanded to do it. We do it every first Sunday of every month. And so if your church doesn't do it, then you be sure to come back and be with us on the first Sunday, because we do it in the first hour the first time. So let me read it to you and explain a little bit to you, then we'll take part in it. In verse 23, Paul is writing, he said, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus in the night in which he was betrayed took bread. We call that the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. There are a lot of names for that. And when Jesus had given thanks, he broke and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. You probably, you got it. When you came in, you had a bulletin. Inside that bulletin, there's a piece of paper. You want that piece of paper. Because when it says, this is my body, you want to look for the body side of that paper. Right? Everybody see that? See the body side? That probably is the first side. It is the first side. This is my body. And watch it. Here's the key word. Do this in remembrance of me. See the remembrance of me business? Do this in remembrance of me. When you take part in the bread, which will be the first thing we take, then I want you, as you chew it, I want you to look at those things and read them, okay? And there are scriptures later for you to read. So there is two elements. There's the bread element, and then there's the cup element. Are you with me? The bread represents the body. And when you take it, it says that I believe the gospel, and this is what I know has occurred for me. When Jesus hung on the cross, his body bore my sins, and this is what I get for it. He took my sins, and what do I get for it? I get these are the gifts. There are nine things, right? One, two, I know you haven't counted them yet, but that's all right. There should be about nine on here. All right. In the same way, he took the cup. Now, the cup, it's got a lid on it. We'll have to take that off in a minute. And he says, this cup is a new covenant. Now, the cup he had was the old covenant, and it's going to be changed to the new covenant. You and I live in the new covenant, period. This cup is a new covenant in my blood. So the bread represents the body of Christ that bore our sins, and the blood represents the blood of Christ, which, you know, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That's an old hymn, right? An old hymn. And as often you do this, do what? In memory of me. So on the backside of that paper, it should be the cup. Willie, on the backside, is that the cup?
Yeah.
So it's on the cup. And that it shows you the things that the cup represents. I think the cup represents the nine things, and the body represents four things, or five, something like that. It's been so long since I've looked at that. And then in verse 26, he's going to issue a warning to you. For as often you eat the bread, you drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. It's a sacred ceremony. It's a sacred ceremony. The Eucharist is. Watch this now. You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, which means we believe he's very much alive. And he's coming again. We call it the second coming. Now he gets into a warning to you. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. What does that mean, unworthy manner? Listen to me now. It's really important. You got to remember this now. Do not take part in the Eucharist if you have willful knowledge of personal sin in your life. It could be mental attitude type sins, sins of the tongue, or overt sins. That'd be three categories. If you're aware of any of those, you do what? You confess them, don't you? 1 John 1:9, I confess my sins. He's faithful and just to forgive me and to cleanse me. Then take part in the Eucharist. Do you understand that? So, the next verse says, let a man examine himself. That's how you do that. And in so doing, he is to eat the bread and drink the cup. He is to. So you self-examination. Look, if you can't find anything, it's fine. But if you can find something, the Holy Spirit's got you on. Your conscience and the Holy Spirit's got you tied up pretty good on something. You confess it before you take part. Agreed? Okay. I don't want you to get in trouble. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. What's he talking about? He's talking about the Lord will discipline you. If you take part in the Eucharist with willful sin in your life, you go like, I don't care, I'm not going to confess it. I don't care what he says. For this reason, many among you are weak, sick, and a number sleep, which is euphemism for a believer dying. If we judge ourselves rightly, how should we do that? Here's the key word, 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we judge ourselves rightly, we will not be judged. When we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord So we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world. You all right? So I'm going to give you a moment of silence to do that very thing, to examine yourself in regard to any kind of personal sin. Either your conscience could be convicting, or the Spirit of God could be convicting. The Word of God could be convicting. Depends on how much growth you have. And so what do? You confess your sin, right? How do I know that? 1 John 1:9. You confess. You do it in silence. You do it to the Lord, right? You judge yourself rightly, and you will not be judged. Are you with me? All right. I'm going to give you a moment of silence. I'll have a word of prayer, and then we're going to do the Eucharist. Well, Father, we're thankful that we've gathered here today at Grace Valley Church. In the favorable year of the Lord, 2023. To tell you that we have a servant's mentality to do the work of the Lord. We pray for Moody. We pray for St. Clair County. And we can preach the gospel to every person out there that has ears to hear. And it will be us to do it. It's how we get into places. We get in there through people with the Word of God and the truth of the gospel. And to be willing to be sent anywhere to proclaim the truth of the Word of God. Here am I, send me. That was Jesus' attitude. He kept saying it over and over again. He sent me. Here I am, send me. Give us spiritual eyes this year, Father, in the favorable year 2023, to have eyes to see the needy for Christ. In our communities, in our nation, wherever we're sent, even to other nations. I pray as we take part in this Eucharist, Father, we would do because we have a deep appreciation for what Christ secured for us when he died our death for sin, took our hell to give us the blessings of time and eternity. Oh, how thankful we are today, Father. Words could never truly express the gratitude of our hearts. We pray that more people will come into the kingdom this year than we could have ever imagined. Our nation needs to be rescued, and the church is the only one that has the true message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I pray we'd be those people, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll take the bread, you may have to work a little bit to get that bread. William always does me well, although he didn't pop my lid here, which I'm going to do now. Here's how it says. Jesus said, he gave thanks, which I just did. He broke it and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Remember to turn that page over. Read the body part. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that Jesus was willing to give up his body Peter writes in 1 Peter 2:24 and 5, how Jesus bore our sins on his body on the cross. I can't even imagine. It would be one thing to go through crucifixion, but to have the sins of the world laid on top of that is more than one could imagine. And so we thank the Son today. For spending 6 hours so we wouldn't spend an eternity on it. In Jesus' name, amen.